This is now the fourth video in a series on how helicopters work. I did an earlier video where I showed the gear reduction that takes place in a helicopter drive system. And if you'd like to watch that video, it is linked in the description. In that video, I used integer gear ratios, and several of you left comments about the need to use prime numbers as the gear tooth count in order to avoid those integer ratios. The name for this concept is a thing called a hunting tooth gear ratio. And while this concept isn't necessary for the operation of gears, hunting tooth designs can reduce noise, vibration, and extend the life of gears. Before using words to define a hunting tooth gear ratio, let's try to use the animation to define that concept visually. Let's start with a gear set that uses a 40 to 20 or a 2 to 1 gear reduction. This is not a hunting tooth gear design. From this view, it's probably difficult to see why this gear pair isn't good for extending the life of gears. If I add color to one of the teeth to make it stand out, it might be easier to see why a non-hunting tooth design is badness for gear longevity. Or maybe it's still not apparent. Sometimes looking at something isn't enough to see a problem. Sometimes we have to change our perspective on how we're observing the problem. In the animation on the left side of the screen, the observer is in the Earth-based frame of reference. The stickman is viewing these gears from a stationary position, so he sees both gears turning. But if we move out of the Earth-based frame of reference and shift to an observer position that's in the rotating frame of reference, we start to see the problem differently. So the motion and speeds of both of the gear sets on the screen are identical. It's only the observer location that changes. The left side of the screen is from the point of view of an Earth-based observer. The right side of the screen is from the point of view of an observer within the rotating frame of reference, as if the observer is sitting on top of the 40-tooth gear. And on the right side of the screen, in this rotating frame of reference, it's maybe easier to see why this particular gear ratio will lead to premature wear. I'll start adding these red contact points on the 40-tooth gear every time the red colored tooth makes contact, and we start to see a repetitive pattern. The red tooth always contacts the same two teeth on the 40-tooth gear. And this isn't just an issue for this one red tooth, this issue applies to every tooth in this gear pair. Every tooth on the 20-tooth gear will mesh with the same two teeth on the 40-tooth gear, and this relationship will never change. The problem this creates is that all of these individual gear teeth have slight differences in microgeometry. These repetitive and unchanging contact points will create a non-uniform wear pattern over the two gears. A better solution is to use a gear pair that results in a hunting tooth. To make our first hunting tooth gear pair, we'll use a prime number gear. So now the gear pair on the left is our same non-hunting 40 to 20 or 2 to 1 gear set. But in the gear pair on the right, I swapped the 20-tooth gear with a 19-tooth gear, so the right side is a 40 to 19 gear pair. Instead of a 2 to 1 reduction, the gears on the right now have a 2.105 to 1 reduction. And watching the red tooth on the 19-tooth gear, we see it's no longer limited to just two mesh points on the 40-tooth gear. Instead, it's meshing after 19, 38, 57, and all of the other multiples of 19 until it contacts every tooth on the 40-tooth gear, and then it repeats the cycle. This is the visual definition of a hunting tooth gear. The gears on the right are hunting, and the gears on the left are non-hunting. This definition in words is a hunting tooth pair is where every tooth on one gear eventually meshes with every tooth on the opposing gear. So it appears that prime numbers are a way to achieve hunting gear ratios, but it turns out that while a prime number is a sufficient condition for hunting, it's not a necessary condition. The necessary condition is to choose gears that don't have a common factor in their tooth counts. 40 to 19 works because 19 is prime, so it has no factors other than 1 and itself, and 40 is non-prime with factors of 2 and 5. 40 to 19 meets the necessary condition for hunting because 40 and 19 don't share any common factors. Next, we'll swap the 19-tooth prime number gear with a 21-tooth non-prime gear. This is now a 40 to 21 tooth gear pair. Neither 40 nor 21 is a prime number. This is now a 40 to 21 gear reduction, or a 1.905 to 1 gear reduction. The factors of 21 are 3 and 7, and the factors of 40 are 2 and 5. Since they have no common factors, this results in a hunting tooth gear pair. With the gears in motion, we see the red tooth on the 21-tooth gear meshes on the 40-tooth gear after 21, 42, 63, and all of the other multiples of 21 until it contacts every tooth on the 40-tooth gear and then repeats this cycle. 40 to 21 is a hunting tooth gear combination, and the necessary condition to achieve hunting is defined as when the numbers of teeth on both gears have no common factors higher than 1. Now that we understand hunting tooth gears, two questions remain. Are hunting tooth configurations always used in helicopter transmissions? And why did I make the original video using integer gear ratios? For the first question, there's a list of references in the description that seem to indicate that, yes, helicopter transmissions use hunting tooth designs. For example, here's a NASA technical report that's specific to helicopter designs, and it says, past experience with high-performance gears and epicyclic gear arrangements show that to reduce noise and dynamic loading, the gear meshes should be designed to be non-factorizing. In addition, hunting tooth gear combinations should be selected whenever possible and practicable. And here's an Army report that's kind of a how-to guide for the Fortran code used to design helicopter gears, and the report says, the following cards check that only compound planetaries are chosen that have hunting teeth. And while not a helicopter-specific design guide, this NASA handbook says, where pitch line velocities are low and cycles are high, hunting tooth gear ratio should be used to distribute wear. Complete hunting occurs when every tooth on a gear mates with every tooth on the other gear. This occurs when the numbers of teeth have no common factors higher than 1. But there are a few references that have more nuanced answers to the question as to whether hunting teeth are always preferred over non-hunting teeth. If you look in your January 2021 copy of Gear Technology, you'll see that Dr. Stottfeld devoted an entire article to the question, is the influence of the hunting tooth theoretical or reality? This article, along with the Handbook of Practical Gear Design, talk about a preference for integer gear ratios in low-load machines with non-superfinished and non-heat-treated gears. And these conditions don't apply to helicopter transmissions. So it seems the predominance of the literature that I was able to find online supports the selection of hunting tooth designs for helicopter transmissions. For the second question of why did I use integer gear pairs in my video, I didn't know about hunting tooth gears until after YouTube viewers commented on my video. I do consider myself an expert in a whole lot of things about helicopters, but apparently the design of gear ratios and drive systems isn't one of those things. And that's what I really like about making these videos. I think I'm doing something to educate some of you that are interested in helicopters and STEM subjects. But as I'm producing these videos and reading the viewer comments, I find that I end up learning so much more about these concepts than I knew before I started. And this is probably a really good example of why engineers work in teams. No one of us has the intellect to achieve great things without first standing on the shoulders of giants. And we tend to think of giants with names like Piasecki, Sikorsky, Fletner, Yuryev, but giants also sit right next to us at our jobs. And together it's this collective knowledge that is far greater than the sum of our individual parts. And harnessing this greatness on the shoulders of giants is what engineers do.